Do an extreme close-up.
Okay, so the webinar. Who was able to actually watch the webinar? Yeah, who was not able to watch the webinar at all? So what was the deal with the webinar? Was it time or was it the technical? Because I know we kind of had some issues with both.
Security online wouldn't let it in, so you have to call help desk to help you put it on.
Okay.
Go to a higher Acrobat.
Oh really? So it was like outdated or something?
Yeah.
All right, copy that. All right, that's good to know. And you had some issues, you just couldn't get it open with your computer or something, right?
Yeah.
All right. What else? If you just didn't have time, that's one thing, but I want to know if there's like technical, just didn't have time?
Just didn't have time.
All right, that's cool. I understand that. I guess I'm asking because I'm wondering if this is something I want to keep in the future?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I think so.
Is it because it's something different, or did you actually like the seminar?
There's several parts that you can get out of it.
Yeah.
So if you're specifically just watching it, you between a certain point, you can get pictures of the actual fire regime, so it kind of makes sense when you're watching it. There's just portions of that different video that the webinar that I think are beneficial.
Okay. All right. It was hard to find. I will admit that I ended up sending the link out later, which I think was helpful, because I went back a few times and tried to find it directly on the website, and I couldn't even like find it. I had to search around for it. I finally found where it was located. But the problem is that they've moved the structure of that website around, and they've added a lot more webinars from 2012 or 13, whenever we did this the first time.
If you go to Lessons Learned, your page, mm-hmm. and you go to the actual lesson, and you have it already on there highlighted,
yeah, that's why
it'll click the hyperlink straight to it.
Oh, on the community page?
Yeah,
that's right.
That's
did you do it that way? Mm-hmm. That's right. You know, I knew that was a method, too, and I was going to point that out to folks.
Bang, bang.
Yeah. Okay, all right, good. Well, I'm glad some of us did. So let's talk about it a little bit. And then, so those of you guys that didn't get a chance to listen to it or watch it, you know, if you can get it later, that's cool. So, you know, I always have the questions we can start out at, but I'm always open to discussing. So I did actually want to talk about, though, the first question, because I like this, and I know we talk about this from time to time in the point of this, over the course of this class, and that is this reference condition or the desired condition. Did you guys pick up on that mm-hmm. part of the webinar? So did you pick up on what he meant by a reference condition or and some of the examples that he gave for finding a reference condition for the landscape?
Yeah, he used different wildernesses and that were not as harmed by, I guess, putting out fires.
Putting out fires, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I know Yosemite was one where they've been using the fire yeast for a while.
Yeah.
And then the Gila, which I can understand that. Anybody that's been there, it's remote, less likely to attack.
Yeah. Have you been there? Actually, I've never been there and seen what they do. My understanding is they do a lot of wildland fire use there.
They use a lot of jumpers in the early season, so like a lot of Macaulays will come boost down there, and a lot of the fires that they have out there, they'll just put two or three jumpers on, and they'll stay out there for an extended amount of time, and people never even know that there's a fire out there.
Yeah, but they're not putting it out, they're just letting it go. Yeah.
Just kind of wrangling it, pushing it, keeping it in check, but as far as putting it out, not really.
When we were there, it was different. For some reason, they had to put it out. But yeah, they said usually, and their crew actually went overboard, put line in their soup, was kind of pissed, but
the
it was still very missed. Yeah. Like, they were big on the actual missed tactics.
Yeah.
You know, usually, everybody writes that off when it's time to... But they were still pretty big.
Okay. So there are areas like that. Did you ever work there? Did you work there? Yeah, that's what I thought. So there, that's cool. Like, I think I always look at the Gila, and, you know, if you remember, Owl Leopold, remember he started on the Gila, and that, I think that was the first wilderness area in the National Forest Systems. So that place has been managed for a long time, just like Yosemite, and it's actually nice to think that there's actual National Forest Systems units that were doing things like the Park Service does, like at Yosemite and Yellowstone and some of those areas. But what does this... So I want to go back to the statement, though. What does the reference condition refer to? That particular terminology. Kind of dancing around it.
Yeah,
Like how it was in the past?
Yeah.
The original OG condition?
Yeah, that's right, the original OG. Yeah, and it's, and so what I heard in the webinar is that it's kind of hard to find those reference conditions. We don't have very many places like that. And so what were some of the tools that they used to find these reference conditions, you know, to figure out what it actually looked like? You remember some of the tools that he used? Some mapping, yeah. Mapping is always useful, especially if it's old enough, yeah.
Do you do rings?
You certainly can do rings. Yep. That's a big way that we reconstruct. And he talked about that a little bit. I think he talked about that when he was talking about looking at the old trees and how, like, the larger diameter trees is what the stand structure was. So if you look at those.
But how often the occurrence of them? How often you have them between intervals or whatever?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the fire regime one. Well, one of the tools he used was those photographs, right? Of course, photographs are only as old as however long photographs existed, which is limited in and of itself. But I really like that picture. Do you guys remember that picture that I have of, I think it was Emerald Point on the Tahoe? Where it actually showed where it had been clear cut in the background, and then it had, and it showed that infill. That's one of the best pictures that I've seen where it shows that where it had been nice and open. And as I always think, too, when I see that, because it's just like a spit of land out onto the water. And if you think about it, like, you know, that's almost kind of like an isolated piece of geography. But even that isolated piece of geography, like, think about what is the fire, like, how many fires are actually going to be through that? But even that was showing an open stand density, an area that, you know, even though it's out in the water, it would have had to have a lightning strike, and how many fires would actually even get to that and creep. Even that was open. But it showed that trees had been filling into it. And it just demonstrates how thick our stands are. And there was other photographs, right? And he showed some photographs of the Sierra San Pedro Martir, I think, down in Baja, versus some of the forest that we have here.
Yeah, I thought the other one in Tahoe was good, too. It showed, like, I think it was a treatment area or something.
Okay.
Showed the non-treat area was just nuked in candlesticks. And
oh, that's right, yeah. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, what were the pictures? So the one picture showed a burn.
It was like left and right and bottom, I think.
And what was the difference between them besides that?
It showed it being in fire regime one, is kind of what it was showing, and then how it moved to fire regime three, and what the difference was out to the landscape after the fire came through.
Yeah, it had showed. Yeah, that's right, because there was actually showing, I mean, you could see that there was still a crown left after the fire had gone through, which is mostly what we want, right? It still was a pretty severe fire. It still was pretty blackened, but there was still a crown left. Yeah. And that's important, right?
I was saying that they had like only 5 to 20% tree mortality, and that and the other one was like 90% or something.
Yeah,
pretty
much 100%. I did get a kick out of him when he was talking about all of it, and he said the human race is the dominant species.
Yeah.
And then I kind of was thinking about it, and I,
because he was talking about why even think about this old, you know, past reference condition. We're living in the future. We're living with people. Right. Deal with it. I mean, we got to plan with people.
Right.
Who cares how it used to be? Let's work on how it needs to be. He struck me as quite progressive.
Yeah. Yeah, and he's our regional ecologist. Just in case you didn't know that. So that's interesting to hear our regional ecologist taking that position, right? So. How do you guys feel about that? Do you think that he's in the right? I mean, I know we've talked a lot about in the class here about should we restore it, what should it look like, and this and that. So were you surprised to hear him say that? Or
no, because he's part of our agency where we're working the land. You know, when you have the people that are the experts, the educational side of this, they're looking at empirical, they're looking at how it used to be, and can we get to that point? I can understand his point of view being the way he works and the way he views the land, as opposed to the education part.
A realist.
Yeah.
We could put some things in place that keep us from further harming it, but to restore it, we're going to have to tear down a bunch of houses and move them. it's not feasible.
Yeah.
But to think in real terms of what we can do to go forward, it's important. Or else we're just going to keep falling further and further behind, trying to, you know, obtain the unattainable.
So where is that line in the sand, or where is that compromise? I mean, like you said, we're not going to tear down houses, obviously, but does that mean we shouldn't do anything to try to...
No, but we can limit where we build them, or, you know, how we build them. That's just one of the big, especially around the brush country, you know, stop letting people encroach and make it an issue, because like you said in it, brush wants to burn, don't put houses in.
Right.
There's no, it's pretty cut and dry.
But, yeah.
And where we already have the homes, that's where I'd like the community defense and not doing these fuel breaks that are going to be take us an hour to get up to the fire anyway, and, you know, retardant might give us a leg to stand on, but all reality, the fuel break we're burning right now, how feasible is that to get resources up there on that road and actually do something?
Yeah, you're kind of an opponent of that. I think I've heard you talk about that before.
Yeah, I don't see the logistical side working at all.
Mm.
But I see where these community defense things, we have concrete. We're pulling up to these things. And we can implement, as a crew guy, I know I can safely put fire on the ground there if I have to already. You know, and just the time to get to these fuel breaks, that's what, we drive that road every day with our burn. And it's not like we can get up there any faster than the people.
Yeah, you can't go any faster with the lights and sirens on, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's been an interesting question. But so say we were to abandon the fuel break work that's out on the divides and that sort of thing. What does that do to our fire management approach?
I'm with Kadri, though, because I've come in from the backside of San Rafael Road or whatever, and that's right there staring you in the face, and it kind of doesn't make sense. And I think it's a lot of time and energy they're putting into that. And I don't see a lot of gain, but there's a lot of structures around there where you can... And I know you're going to fight the land ownership issue, but I think if you did more work around where you could around those structures, where the forest butts right up, you know, to their property and their houses right there, that would be more of a direct, they'd have more impact right away if you had fire than up on a ridge.
I like the mosaic up high. I know we've never done that in years, and it'd be difficult to implement, but...
You mean patch burning?
Yeah.
Mosaic patch burning?
And a little, you know, closer to the community up on top there. But Jim brought it up too, how it always burns there. It's pretty much on the same path. And due to the winds up there or something. What were you saying when we were up there in reference to the matcha even?
I gotta cycle back to all my gibberish I spit out sometimes. You know, it's constant. So every fire, if it were to start, I'd say later in the day and continue, it would maybe get bigger. But, well, I'm sorry, earlier in the day. However, it always starts more towards the afternoon, evening. It runs to the top of the ridge. The sun goes down. It goes out.
Yeah.
That's it. It doesn't go any farther. I mean, unless it has, you know, something to push it, meaning like you get the winds out of the La Jolla Canyon down there in the flat from Paula Palma. If you got something on that side that pushes it, it'll come up and it'll hit. But it just, once the sun goes down, it kind of spills and goes out. And that's just been the standard for however long I worked here. And picking it up from everybody else that has been there.
That's actually kind of interesting, because where I came from, it was the same thing. Mm-hmm. If you catch it on the ridge or just on the backside, the sun usually goes down by the time it gets there.
Right.
And we're going to pick it up right at the top or at the backside.
Same
thing.
Same thing the same way.
And when is that not going to happen?
Just fire.
When we have our east wind fires, and that's a big part of this class. They're not designed for extreme.
Right. Yeah, nothing is.
But you guys have the Lake Elsinore effect that makes it burn.
That's only
different.
Localized to that area, though.
It's only that area.
Sunrise gets that, too.
Anywhere there's a lake.
It does happen in other places, yeah.
Some people call it the Henshaw effect, the Windy Gap. It's the same thing.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it gets on that side, on that east grade side. You guys realize what you're saying is completely sacrilege, right?
Well, I mean,
but look at where we're gonna put the on my district where we're putting in and where they want to burn now. Just to go up there and burn it, I mean, it's your goal. Everyone that goes says, well, we're going up there, it's a day. You're committing a day to drive up there. What is it, 2 hours to drive up there or something?
Yeah.
Just one way. And even if you're on a fire, 2 hours, what's it, you know, what are you saying? What are you buying by doing a little fuel break up there? If you can't get people up there, it takes 2 hours to get people up there.
Do we not go to fires because it takes a little
while
to drive to it?
No, but what I'm saying is it's going to burn past that point anyways, right?
Well, what maybe. You're buying is like the Silverado fire. They burned off the fuel break we're doing right now, so you can buy something up there.
Yeah.
I don't know. In my career, I've just seen those fuel breaks. It burns through them. That's what I... You know, when you get a normal year fire, yeah, you might buy something, but the extreme, it's just... I don't know. And anymore, we're going to the extreme.
Yeah.
It's not burning normal. And so we're not, it's, you know, I've been standing on fuel breaks on the Angeles and watched it burn through the fuel break. We had to go over there and literally put it out. And the fuel break wasn't doing anything.
Well, the fuel brakes are not designed to stop fire.
No, but it, even with retardant, it had retardant on it. And it burned right through.
They should have put more retardant on it.
They were trying. They were trying.
Thinking it up.
It's, I don't know. You know, I got to be honest with you. I agree with a lot of what you guys are saying, but at the same time, I don't know if we're in a position to just walk away from this work. And I hear this. I have to be honest with you. I think it's a pretty weak argument to hear it takes a while to get up there, even for the work part of it, because that's what we do. We work for the Forest Service. Our forest is up a road that's an hour and a half to get to. No one ever really complained about it before. And what are you guys going to do in the meantime?
No, I'm not I don't think it's the complaint of going driving up there. It's my thought is you're spending a lot of time, energy, and finances.
That's what we do.
To put it in, but is it effective? That, you know what I mean? Is that direction buying you anything?
Yeah.
Or can you put the money somewhere else and buy you something? Community defense or more? You know what I mean? Orange County's got started to build houses right up to the forest pretty soon. Is that where it should be?
Well, what does our land management plan say about the houses that they're building right up next to the forest boundary?
We're not doing anything about it.
Never knew anything about it, so...
Oh, I understand that. I'm just saying in the future...
But in the future, what does our land management plan say about it in the future?
It has to be rewritten, though, soon, right? Or 5 years?
In probably 5 to 10 years, yeah. And I don't think that's going to change. We're not going to reverse course and say, yeah, we'll start taking on everybody else's... you build a house next to the forest, we'll take care of you. I guarantee you that will not change. So what we have is what we have, right? We have these legacy communities that are still there, and we have our fuel breaks. What's the success rate on the fuel breaks that are out there? Remember from the papers?
35%.
Higher than that.
46.
Yeah, what was the one we wrote about?
Yeah, it's 46% is what they say. Very good. See, you had Jim.
I was close. So have you been on a fire where a fuel break was, where it was an advantage at all, or you never seen one?
Well, so I refer back to
trying to think.
Picking it up in the fuel break, it works. Slows it down, you pick it up in the fuel break, or just adjacent to it on the other side, it works.
Or you punch a dozer line through it?
Yeah. To where fires are, you know, have everything, all the energy behind it to blow through a fuel break, did it work? No, but that was a different scenario, you know. I don't look at them as the same, you know. It has to be on two different planes. You either have the most extreme to where it's going to blow through anything anyways, which we don't even pick up fires anymore. If you really look at it that way, we were just talking about this morning, me and Susie.
Yeah.
And I said the difference between the older crowd and the new crowd. The older crowd never seen real huge fires consistently 4, 5, 6 times a year. They seen it once every 2, 3 years. And then when the 2003 came along and they had these multiple huge fires, their eyes were like, whoa, and the crowd, the salts were going, man, I've never seen fire like this. To where the younger generation, they're seeing it consistently, 3, 4, 5, 6 large campaign fires a year, that this is like an average thing. And we don't pick them up. The weather comes in 3 months later, the fire goes out, everybody goes, yeah, we got it. And it was like, no, the weather got it. You just were here to kind of do something, to waste some cash. Realistically, that's me looking at it. So,
well, those are the campaign fires, yeah.
Well, I'm just talking
to general. And fuel breaks can be used on
those? Very rarely we pick up a fire anymore under an acre with, you know, dry, windy conditions.
Right.
Very rare. It happens, like I said, the sun goes down, we get to a place where we can pick it up, we pick it up, everybody goes, we did it. If there's a consistent weather anomaly that pushes,
then we don't pick it up for weeks, and when we do finally pick it up, somehow pick it up our road somewhere, great big box, we did it, you know. So, two different things. Fuel brake work? Sure. Fuel brake don't work because of the weather anomaly? No.
But they're not designed to stop sand
and
fire.
Right, yeah. Right.
There's no
nothing does. Right. I mean, that goes right through cities. It's concrete jungle. It still burns shit.
But there's that 50-50. Or it helps, it doesn't help.
Right. But it's the, you know, I mean, there's the head, but you still need advantages, and that's where the fuel breaks. You know, there's sweet spots. It might be a flank. It might be,
sure.
You know, for the when the sand end breaks down, it's going to come back. And, you know, on the Pimacha fire, I was up top with Tom Brand, was the strike team leader, and we burned off for miles up top, and we were looking at the back door off fuel brake on the top. You know, so it's not always stopping the head, but it's, you know, in these huge fires, you need to start somewhere.
But that's also a different point. So, you know, using the fuel brake to your advantage, being able to burn off the lighter fuels quickly with a small, minute line in there to hold it gives you another chance to picking up a large fire, say something like that.
It also provides an opportunity to put a dozer line through a lot easier, which is how we picked up the Silverado fire up on the top. So you're able to put a dozer line through.
When we did the mountain fire, I mean, that's one of the things that the output of that was the advantage of fuel brakes. We have, like, historically, probably since the 70s, when they documented, had fuel brakes in different areas, but for that particular fire, it was able to, you were able to put it out where it bumped up to the urban interface, and that was an advantage where it didn't just rip through some of the community that was pre-treated. And but one of the things that they did say was that where CAL FIRE in their defense zone and the other zone where it's like 3 miles from the community didn't merge with where Forest Service did their treatment. So in that zone, it wasn't effective.
Right.
Because it didn't meet with each other. And that's
there was a gap?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's a suggestion when you do have treatments to work together with your CAL FIRE, whoever else is doing it, so that you're not like kind of undoing yourself with that zone that's not treated. So that was one issue. The other was just that you had a place to plan B at a fuel break. So there was a suggestion then to keep up with your fuel breaks and won't let them get grown in and be effective to kind of clean them up around where you think you could catch it if it worst effect happened. But there's other, like the Willow Fire, I think the Silverado Fire, the Wallow Fire, there were all zones that were pre-treated on a mass scale that stopped a much greater danger from the community.
And those were less a fuels treatment and more of a forest restoration treatment, mm-hmm. like a mass, like you said. Yeah, those are all very good examples. Mm-hmm. Especially the failure, too, because we have a lot of examples of failures, and as an organization, we always focus on those failures. There's a few things. I want to go back to what you're saying about the fuel brakes and that. It's actually kind of funny because you're more or less advocating, and I'm not criticizing, because I'm kind of ambivalent about fuel brakes. I think it's an effective tool, but, you know, also sort of question it. It's that 50-50 thing, right? At what point, and the real question that we're dealing with right now with our fuels management program in Southern California is, what is that worthwhile break-even point? Is 46% enough? You talk to these older guys, and they're like, even if it's 20% or 10%, it's worth it to do it. Yeah, any chance at all. And I'd be like, eh, I'm not sure that adds up given this day and age. But 50% is kind of, it's like 50, it's a coin toss. You know, and that's pretty good, you know. And that's better than a hitter's average. But I think it's funny because the position you're advocating, if I'm interpreting it correctly, is sort of similar to the Halsey, Keeley, that whole group, which is that let's stop doing this landscape stuff. Let's focus on the communities. And let's just let fire range as fire will range in the backcountry. And I don't want to put words in your mouth, but if we were to abandon that and just to go to the communities only, that's kind of what that would leave us with, right?
I'm a proponent of that. I'd have to say, yeah.
Yeah.
But at the same time.
But why? Oh, but go ahead. Sorry.
As we put, because my biggest thing is access on it. It really is, and that's it. But why can't we put fuels money into making the access better? also. We're doing this as a strong, yeah, as a place to, and I agree, fuel breaks aren't meant to stop fires, they're meant to give us a place to hopefully grab a hold and do something.
Yeah.
I think I understand that concept, but if we're putting this money, all this money in the fuel break, why can't we put some of that money into making our access better in, and then upping that percentage of chance of it working?
I can see that.
You know, that's a great question. That question's been asked before.
That's a good point, because you said that fuel breaks aren't meant to stand alone. We all know that, so, but if you can't get there in time, then all that work is...
And I know in an hour, it takes us about an hour to get to most points of that, coming from the top and the bottom. In an hour, your fire typically hasn't done too much where it's out of control. Depends on, there's a couple places where our fuel breaks real thin and it's real nasty if we get start there, which they're very unlikely. Yeah, unless it was a lightning holdover or something.
But the fire is so dynamic, you don't know where it's going to start. Is it going to start, you know, early season? Maybe it's going to start in May. You know, maybe it's going to start at night. It's going to have the wind. It's, you know, it. So you never really know. You know, you're talking about one aspect. You know, it starts right below it. You know, initial attack, it's running right for it. Maybe your chances aren't good, but that's just one scenario out of a lot.
But I think overall, if we took an approach of, you know, improving our response times, that will help our field breaks be more successful overall, period.
That's true. I think that probably comes down to
culture.
That kind of, well, culture for one, but more like the
stab, because that's the way I see it.
I'm looking at it more. I would use the term structure. The way we're structured is that money from Congress was not designed for it. It says remove dry. You know, what does the National Fire Plan say about hazards? Mm-hmm. Remove dry brush and trees. And while building a road would move you to that end, we don't even do that. Like fire suppression money doesn't even build fire roads, you know, engineering money. And the other thing is, I don't even, like, I could probably spend all $1.6 million to chip seal the Palomar Divide, you know, like for 1 year, and that would blow the entire fuels budget. Because that work tends to be engineering work and road construction, that stuff, C&M work is extremely expensive compared to cutting trees. So while your point is valid, I think there's internal processes type structural stuff.
I think though, and I've said it before too, modifying the way we're doing prescribed fire, instead of doing the long strip, you know, go out, throw a dot down, the modified lightning that I was calling, you know, being able to throw that down a certain part of the year and just letting it go and creating a natural fuel break is what I kind of call it. So let it creep off the sides of the roads, let it creep into the old standing brush, let it get its wider portions where it wants to get its wider portions. Going that route rather than, you know, taking that strip, constant strip,
you
might as well pave it at that point.
It's very avant-garde. I like it. It'd be nice to be able to... They used to do it that way, though, right?
Yeah.
They used to do it that way. That's what they say.
Only 20 years ago? I mean, my first year on this district is the last year we didn't cut line, really, on Palomar Divide.
Right.
After that, it was like everywhere on the divide you put line in.
So
even if it was wide as this table and the fuel break literally came down, it was like, the line's right there. Why are we putting line here? You can pull a hose to it.
Yeah.
You know, it was silly.
So what changed? Was there an event?
Once again, I think that was culture. I think it was, if we put lines on everything, then we'll get the okay to burn. And we won't restrain ourselves from saying, you know, well, you guys can't burn, you can't control it. That culture changed with when the Rangers kind of came in and kind of took over. It was more or less this was my feeling, I can't speak for in general, but that if I'm going to sign this, I want a 100% guarantee I'm not going to jail. So by you putting lines and hose on everything, that covers it. I feel safe and happy. That's what I think really changed it.
Yeah, that might be.
Plus, it was knowledge is power. You know, the older folks were going out, and they didn't share a lot of that with people. You know, it was, I have that power. And
those techniques, that skill set.
And then they left, and it was like, oh, I forgot to share that. They'll figure it out one day, you know, 10 years down the road.
Well, the thing I've talked to a few of them about, too, is the thing to consider is that the fuel age got higher, too. So, you know, when those guys were burning in the 80s, you know, it was only a 50-year-old, and now it's like an 80 or a 90-year-old fuel. But I'm not sure how much of a difference that would make,
but
although it's harder.
That's my point, though. Since we've been pulling back every
5 years.
Yeah.
Now we're, you know, that fuel got bigger, and when every year they just let it do its thing, it'd go into that same fuel area and clean out whatever it would do 5 years prior, you know. I mean, we're still burning it consistently the same way they did it. We've just put lines, and now once we go back in there to reopen and we hit that line, it's like, okay, we hit that line, and we're just not hitting
it. Instead of letting it get a little bigger.
Yeah, like, we're not even hitting that target.
Yeah. So one thing I also want to address, I want to go back to this, is like you talk about access, and as I'm driving those roads, I think about, you know, what would be like if I'm driving up to a fire. Just having that fuel break around those roads, frankly, to me, is a huge comfort zone.
Oh, yeah.
Because would you rather be driving those roads with monster brush on both sides up to a fire?
No.
Or would you rather be driving through the fuel break up to a fire?
Yeah.
You know, because you know it gives you that margin when you were, like you said, an hour or an hour and a half away from a true safety zone. So I think that alone, just the fact that it gives you a reduced fuel, it gives you that comfort to be able to get up to a fire. Even if the fire is already slopped up and over, at least you can drive up to it.
It's still an anchor point, even if it's on the other side of it.
Exactly.
It still is.
So I think there's a lot of value to that. And honestly, I've come to the conclusion that that's probably the most value for especially those big divides, because there's a road there. And if there's a road there, we're going to drive it to get to a fire.
Mm-hmm.
And if we're going to drive those roads to get to a fire, especially if it's a long way up there, and that's the divide, the Palomar Divide, the North and South Main Divide, any of those places, you know, it's nice to have a fuel break along that road to be able to get to, just for safety's sake. To be able to turn around, to be able to burn out real quick if you need to, and anchor points, like you said.
And I agree. And I think we've gone towards where I like, because that working on that fuel break makes more sense than some of the other ones we did up
here. Yeah.
What was it, the Butterfield? That was just not off the road. It was like a ridge line over.
Yeah.
And it seems like we're getting away from that, and we are doing more of these community defense things. Cause,
right.
I mean, that was a new project, from my understanding, when we did Stone Ridge.
Mm-hmm.
And then Stone Ridge, even what we're doing out here near Ramona, that, to me, is just a big community defense fuel break.
North Ramona, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think we are trending in that direction anyway. And getting, like, when we analyzed the fuel breaks last year, I thought that was great.
Right, and that's the one thing to talk about too, is we are trying to be more focused on what fuel breaks we actually do, and it's the other forests as well are doing the same process, and I think that gives us a lot of credibility that we're not just saying we're doing them all and whatever, you know, we're gonna say, well, we'll take a deliberate look and try to prioritize and see which ones have actual tangible empirical value, right?
And what's manageable, because they all are going to require return.
Mm-hmm.
So when we had a bunch of fuel breaks, are we truly going to be able to manage these to work?
Yeah.
I tell you, the place to look on this district, really, though, within the next 5 years, is to go back and relook at the Changa area.
Yeah.
And all the homes that are being built. There's nothing on that side. Every, you know, so often they have a big Bale Lake fire or a big Pechanga fire. And I don't think anything's really, every time it happens, oh, we need to do something up here. Never do it. And there's a few little slivers here and there on some ridge lines, but.
But they're building those houses, it's all like the compact communities and.
Yeah.
With space, defensible space, or.
Yeah, I don't know.
No?
I haven't. I never went back in there and did like any pre-attack look.
Right.
I just was like, oh, it's going to happen. So, you know, but if you look at every couple of years, reoccurrence, that Changa area is going to maybe.
Yeah, I don't think we pay much attention to that extreme north end.
The wilderness and.
Mm-hmm.
You're building that's been typical.
Close to it, too. Back in Trip, there's Los Caballos, you take it up to the south, and you take De La Rosa, and you can see that you're building up communities right next to the wilderness.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Well. Yeah, something to look at.
They're creepy.
I live across here from the wall. There's houses all around the Changa of the Reservation.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's right, because they've been building those for a while. Kind of infilling around that south
to the
or north side.
Temecula's starting to move to the east up in the hills.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Going towards that direction.
Yeah, that's going to impact us, but like I said, that's why we try to protect ourselves with the plan. And, you know, when we talk to those communities, owning people or whatever, however they're building them. That will be something. You know, this is where I'm hoping our WUI analysis, which we're doing next, is going to start identifying those areas and characterizing them and seeing where that work needs to be done. So, all right, cool. So is there anything else on the webinar that you guys wanted to talk to or anything that struck you? What's that? You like? I'm glad you liked it.
I watched it 3 times.
Damn.
I like to focus on the
fire regime one.
Uh-huh. And keeping the threes, you know, keeping the one from going to the three and putting a lot of work into that.
Right, and he said it's kind of an easy recipe for it, right? Mm-hmm. That's why I like. That's why Fire Regime 1 and Long Needle Pine is really pretty straightforward. Yeah, pretty easy to do. And that's where we always talk, like people always talk about, oh, there's not enough fire in the ecosystem. It's really, it's not enough fire in those Fire Regime 1 situations. Like the true Fire Regime 3s and 4s, we really don't need to do anything, right? But those 1s is where we, and that's a lot of the West. It's not all the West, but it's a lot of it. It's fun. That's what, I mean, it's all what Mount Laguna is. And I think probably some parts of Palomar, too, although we're having a debate about that. All right, well, I want to beat a dead horse. This is a good conversation one way or the other. And I want to make sure Dan has plenty of time to talk, so... is that good? You guys good with that? Okay, and I got your... we're going back to a paper. Did you like it that it wasn't a paper? Was that a nice little break? Yeah, that was kind of the intent. Well, too bad we're going back to papers.
Yay!
I'll talk about that after lunch. So, all right. Do you need like 5 minutes? If you guys need 5 minutes, a little coffee break. We'll reconvene. Let Dan get set up. All right, man. Hey, here's a little clicker thing for you too. Introduce Dan again. He's a good friend of mine and a colleague, the Forest Prescribed Fire and Fuel Specialist for the San Bernardino, and I really appreciate you coming and giving this presentation. The one thing I wanted to say is that this presentation is actually Unit 3. We're back to Unit 3, so this should have been the unit after the Intro to Fire Ecology one, and would have been before Jeff Hayes' talk when we talked about NEPA. So we're talking about left side and project development and stuff. So we're going back to the future a little bit. Do your civil service.
Yeah, I got stuck in, I got a jury summons and you know, thought I could get out of it easy and got stuck in court for a month. So that was a fascinating life experience, but that's why I'm late to be here. So.
How long have you been on this December? Since
mid-December, and I came from the Angeles, it was a Fuels BC over there for 4 years. And I took the job in December and then went straight to jury duty for a month, so just getting my feet kind of on the ground over there. So Stephen just gave me, it was a while ago that he gave me the task of talking about project development. And I initially was going to head towards NEPA and try to segue into what Jeff was talking about, but then I thought about it for a while, and I think that, to develop a project, I think it's good to start from the beginning to see, do you just jump into a project, and what your background is to why, where do you start? So I guess I've got a while, and so I kind of want, it's been a while since I worked on this forest. So I recognize a few people, but if you guys could help me out, tell you your name and why you're taking the curriculum, what you're after, if you want to become a fuel specialist or what your intention is, and that really helped me out with your background. So
Ray Vega, A Fuel at Corona Fire Station. Before that I was down here in the Palomar, and just to understand why I do field work in the wintertime when I was in the fields crew. That's pretty much.
Okay. What about looking forward? Do you want to stay more in suppression or?
Suppression.
Yeah. Okay.
Sal Torres, I'm the engine captain up at El Carrizo Engine 23. The reason why I'm taking this class is because when I was on the San Bernardino, I have my RXB3. I'd be told to go out and burn. Why are we going out and burn? Just because we don't want you guys in the station. And then I come here and I see people interested in why we're burning, and I have no idea. You know, my guys asking me or people asking me, why are we burning this? What is this for? And I want to have questions for them. I want to have the answers for them, so that way I can respond. And then, you know, going more into prescriber and the RSP2 stuff, I want to know myself why we're doing the treatments we're doing.
Okay.
Brooke Nunez, Tribeco District, and the same thing, just for the knowledge, so that when we had an employee that he went to this curriculum and he was bringing back things to teach us, and so I thought I probably should go to the same curriculum so that I could teach the other people once he's gone.
Okay.
Just knowledge.
My name is Jason Luong. I'm up on the Tribeco as well. I'm at the same station as Sal on the other engine. I'm only a senior firefighter there, so I'm fairly new in my career. But I took this course because I wanted to try to have more answers of the why. Like, why are we out doing project work? What is our objective? Mm-hmm. A lot of those answers weren't being given to me, so I figured, since the same employee went to this and he came back and he was all ramped up and excited about this, I was like, oh, right. So that gave me a better understanding of what I'm doing and be able to do my job better. And whether stay in suppression or go to fuels, future's a wide open door.
Sure, okay.
Derek Codry, I work for Palmer Hot Shots, the senior. We had a couple guys go through it, and the reason I wanted to do it is it's kind of what they said, the understanding, but for more of the implementation and trying to do it the right way. Anybody can put fire on the ground, keep it in check, but start to figure out how to burn things while we're burning them this way and just implementing it properly.
Okay.
Charles Scott, superintendent on Elk Creek Sucker 2. Just to gain more knowledge, where I came from on the Angeles, it was all pile burning. And by the time we got to half the piles, they were either biodegraded or there's so many of them on the Santa Clara. But just over there, I had my RSP3 for like 10 years, but I didn't even understand most of the fuel stuff. I just had the fire portion of it. Then I came here, and it's very fuels-based. And before I left, the last person I worked for, last superintendent, was Kevin, and he had a forestry degree. And I learned a lot from him and just different things in the forest, other than fire, which was good. They kind of sparked an interest and just keep building on that.
Okay.
I'm Tizzy Carlson from the San Jack. I've been there for quite a while. I do quite a bit of things, wear a lot of hats as a patrol. And I think that learning more about this is really good, because we need to beef up our plan a little bit better on the San Jack, and it just gives you an understanding of that. So as far as going into fields, I think I can do both. And I would like to develop that, so it's good to learn that information. But also, I do GIS, and I've been doing that for a little bit to assist with prescribed burns and mapping and whatnot. But I'm also a PIO, and that seems to be a bigger issue that needs to be developed to tell the people why we're doing it, and seems like that's a huge, big deal that needs to be zoomed into a little bit better, especially when you're dealing with people that are very affected by fire in their communities. And it gets to money issues, and it goes up higher to even Congress and why we're doing it. So I just think that bridge of communication needs to be better. And then there's also the climate change issues that are political, and I would like to know more about that and how we're going to integrate into describing that and communicating that out.
Okay.
And I know that we have had history in our district with the matrix and whatnot, and I'm looking to be able to develop that as well.
Okay, great.
My name is Lorenzo Miranda, Oregon Dispatch. I took this class. I want a better understanding of the forest I work in currently and the people that are there.
Okay.
Jim Snow, San Bernardino, San Jack. My ultimate goal is fuels battalion, some type of fuels program. I like fuels. Fuels is one of the only things you could really manage for, unlike suppression, where it's an after action mainly. So that's it.
Okay.
Maria, I took this class to better develop my knowledge of the fuel side. My career has always been focused on fire management and fire, but not to the extent of knowing why. So it's tacking on to what Sal said, it's the knowledge, getting that knowledge and empowering and passing on that information to the third generation.
Okay.
Sarah Billings, Plumas National Forest Fire Ecologist. I ran into Stephen on a fire and had the opportunity to work with him, and he told me about this fuels curriculum, and so hopefully I'm going to take something similar back up to the north side of the state, but just learning everything about what you guys deal with and how fuels are managed down here has been really eye-opening.
Okay, good. So that's a... good range, and I think a lot of good intention for understanding. What I've seen with was involved with putting on a curriculum last year on the Angelus, and a lot of the same intention, you know, looking to understand and some, you know, in kind of getting ready for today, I was thinking a pattern that I've seen that, you know, people can be intimidated by fuels, that it's you know, it can be, it's complex or, you know, just hard to understand. And but I want to, you know, kind of by going through this, explore, you know, your backgrounds and show you, you know, that a lot of this stuff, you have a lot of advantages in, you know, in the fire path, that you know, I think for developing a project, you have a lot of excellent experiences that should, you know, I'm sure we've all been on projects where you thought, why are we here? There's this is a poorly designed project. So, you know, I think, you know, people that come from fire into fuels, you know, have the power to design projects that are effective, you know, that your people are going to be out there, that you can say with confidence, this is why we're here, and I've seen this work before, and this is what we're moving towards. So, you know, my angle with this, you know, in going through the slides, I'm starting... I started in Florida with the state, and I'll kind of go through my history, and I haven't done this before with the PowerPoint, but I was thinking that, you know, so I have all the, you know, a lot of the lettering and the bullets are in white, but then things that really were like maybe teachable moments or highly influenced things that I came across that I'd imagine you guys have a lot of similar experiences for that helped me develop, you know, my angle into projects. So I've got those in black. So as we go through, you know, those are things that really hit me, you know, maybe change my angle or influence with, you know, with developing a project. So kind of, I haven't gone through a class with this before, so we'll kind of see how it goes. I have no idea how long it'll take. I think probably more than 10 minutes, but we'll see. So we'll go through... To start, you know, how I got to the fuels management, becoming a fire and fuel specialist, and designing a project of your own, and you know, getting to implement that project. I think that's the most attractive and desirable, and maybe, you know, a lot of you guys are into that, you know, the same concept, that eventually, you know, you have your ideas, your experiences, what's going to work, and how incredible it feels to, you know, to be involved with the project over the years and then see it burn, you know, like on Friday. I mean, there's, you know, Jim got was part of a prescribed burn on my old district on the Angelus that I spent years putting that together, and to hear that it burned, I mean, that feels good, you know, to help design and put together and then see a project, you know, work. And And then I couldn't even imagine if one day, you know, one of these projects, a fire hits it and it stops, or it gives you an advantage. I mean, sounds pretty incredible, you know, for that type of thing to happen. So that's a good influencer in, you know, why I come to work. So I started in the South in a place called Tatesell State Forest in the Florida Panhandle. Have any of you guys been down to Region 8 for PFTC? Nobody's been, you know, a few? Yeah? So this is, I've got a map on the next page. And this is a pretty common site
you know, in Florida, you know, a lot of prescribed burning, heavy fuels, big dark, smoke from prescribed burns, and it's such an active program that really year round we would burn. And my forest was, I think it was 100,000 acres or so, and we would burn 20,000 acres a year every single day. You know, if it was in July or if it was in January, you know, we were always looking to burn. And it was, the burn plans were simple. It was the state, so burn plans were two pages, basically where, you know, and why. It was pretty incredible, and this is where I got my start. So I've always preferred prescribed burning and fuels, to wildfire, but, you know, the two do go hand in hand. So that's, you know, that's where I got my start. Started in 2001 on Tatesell. So Tatesell is it's this little, it's so familiar with Florida, and this is it's this chunk of ground right here, and it's all considered forgotten Florida. You know, you've got Madness down here. This is all gone crazy. You know, the whole coast around Disney World, and a lot of the Florida is not. Which, you know, when you hear Florida, you think. Not prescribed burning, or maybe we do, but you know, for the most part, I think most people in the state think Florida isn't really a ecologically diverse state. But where Tatesell was, it was surrounded by Apalachicola National Forest, Eglin Air Force Base, Big Bend State Park. If you guys have been to Osceola, is up here, Ocala. So this whole area. It was called Forgotten Florida, and it was all part of what I would learn in my introduction here. And again, this is kind of part of the trigger. This is the Apalachicola River, and this was all the Apalachicola watershed, and it all spilled into Apalachicola Bay, Caraway Bay, and this was where it's one of the biggest areas for oyster production. You know, every day it was pretty fascinating. Now I live in LA, and it's nothing like Caraway, which was about 500 fishermen basically that lived there. So, you know, pretty big change in cities, and they'd have the wooden oyster boats and the big, looked like rakes to, you know, they would go, I think they called it tonguing, and they would stand on the side of the platform of the boats, and they would go and harvest oysters, but it was seasonal. So, the quality of the oysters had a lot to do with if they had too much fresh water that was flushed into the Apalachicola Bay, then the oysters wouldn't be safe. You know, they needed some kind of salt water component to keep the bacteria levels down. Or so that was as I was working here, I started to see that we were part of something that was connected to something else. It wasn't just a job. It wasn't just fire. It wasn't just a paycheck, but how we manage this land in the watershed impacted how another industry, the seafood industry. So I thought that was pretty interesting to me. To start to see those connections. Tatesell was this, it maybe 100,000 acres up like this, and then this was more. It was kind of upland, a little more. Longleaf pine, a little drier, the Apalachicola National Forest. But in the 30s and 40s and 50s and 60s, this whole area was purchased by several large timber companies, and they over time, they saw the value in highly productive soil, so they drained and gridded out this. This one's a little zoomed out, but on a lot of aerial photographs, and we've got a couple further in. You can see what they've done with the roads. Each road had a ditch on either side, and they basically wanted to drain the whole swamp, and that, really screwed up the fishing industry. Over time, people started to see the relationship between the water and the seafood, the shrimping and the oyster industry. So in, I think, in the 80s and 90s, the state of Florida bought this land, and their intention was to improve, restore the watershed, and they granted, or they gave that task to the Division of Forestry, and through time, the intention was to plug up and you know close roads, close ditches, and re you know kind of get the water sheet, the water flow back in a more natural, more filter system from Atlanta, Tallahassee, you know. A lot of the agriculture and crap, you know, pollution would come down if it was coming down really quickly and just flush through, and you know, big impact on the industry. So the state, through a lot of different efforts, you know, looked to slow down and restore, you know, the watershed. So I thought that was a good way to start in fire. So again, you know, this is a zoomed in area, stormwater runoff, ditches and canals, you know, a lot of road systems throughout. You can just see that this whole area is a grid, and the water would just quickly flush through after big storms, after hurricanes down, and it, you know, didn't have that filter system in place. Something that I picked up, you know, right away was each of us had about 50,000 acres of land, and we were given a real basic GIS system. So, you know, right away I saw the power in integrating you know, GPS data from the field and creating maps and you know, for prescribed burns. As the forester from my zone, we were required to do all GIS and mapping skills. And I see that in fire is kind of lacking. You know, everybody can run a GPS, but there's a lot of power in the ability to transfer from the field into an app and back and forth. And now that we have Avenza and Gaia, you know, everybody likes to have fire maps, you know, on their phone. So that's something that I'm looking to kind of filter through in the San Bernardino program. You know, that I think there's a big need for people to be able to create maps, and that they be two-way, you know, start from data in the field, run it into you know, their own GIS system, and then make a map on your phone. So that was something that stuck with me in the beginning, all the, you know, the power and mapping skills. So this is you know, a picture of, you know, the big part of the forest plan goal, you know, restoration from private industry. You know, watershed values and seafood industry, these were just more, you know, just saw the peripheral or the connection, you know, from a fire job into, you know, how it was connected to the greater world. So it's kind of a common picture. You would see a timber stand that was obviously built, you know, in the swamp. You know, we would run timber harvest and pull out the trees and close up the roads and look to, you know, kind of get the watershed back in place. In other areas where off species slash pine, loblolly pine were built on little sandhill ridges where it was originally longleaf pine. You know, that was a big part of the restoration effort. And all these areas received prescribed burning site prep. And once the longleaf pine were in place, we did seedling release prescribed burning to get the system, you know, fire back into the system.
Like I hit the wrong button.
And so yeah, this was, you know, a few other new term historical fire intervals, and throughout, you know, you'd see in some of these stands that were just totally planted with slash pine and rose. Then you'd start to see these little populations of, you know, if you guys saw these in the south, they're pitcher plants, and wiregrass, it's a savanna. And you can see, you know, just over time, start to see, you know, maybe historical photographs, older maps that showed kind of the layout of how things were, you know, how the system worked. You know, you had little sand ridges with longleaf pine. They took the lightning. They, you know, the lightning would spread into savanna, into the meadows, and, you know, the whole system was was functioning, but it was so far out of whack that, you know, through our tools, through fuels work, you know, through cutting areas that were overgrown or planted with the wrong species, reintroducing fire, you start to see, you know, this could have been the picture before. After 10 or 15 years of work, you know, you undo the industry, and then you have pretty cool savannas, and, you know, the land was very resilient, you know, to kind of get it back into place. So you know, this was part of the sponge and the that filtration system. So it was all pretty, I thought, set the hook, you know, pretty good for historical fire intervals and how the whole system worked together. So, you know, the barbed wire is pretty appropriate. Our land was all screwed up, and right across one of the main roads was the Apalachicola National Forest, and there they had been working their land for 75 years, so we'd go over and help, and their burns were it was really incredible. The, fire adapted systems that everything was working in place, and we did a little bit of scraping around wildlife trees. You know, they had a healthy population of the red cockaded woodpeckers. You know, their swamps were intact. The longleaf pine was functioning. You know, different age classes. If they had fires, they would have lightning strikes and wildfires. They were manageable. If they happened on our side of the fence, it was a disaster. It would just blow out the whole area. So, starting to see how, you know, when you manage the land, you know, it's healthy. The fires are resilient, and you can easily manage the fires, you know, versus on our side, everything was out of whack. So I thought that was, a pretty profound difference in just that one road that that showed the different management styles. This is another picture of a healthy, fire resilient, longleaf pine ecosystem, wildlife habitat, a lot of red cockaded woodpecker trees, and if you can imagine, communities throughout, it's pretty typical in the South. You know, if it's you just imagine fire behavior in something like this, or you know, versus a place that had been abandoned or built in thick areas that it didn't have fuels work or prescribed burning. You know, just your comfort into taking engine, your module, your crew into a place like this versus, it's just the difference, I think, is sped up in the South with all the sun, all the moisture, but the two together are pretty, it's pretty obvious. So on my first burn, I had been there a month. I was maybe 21 or 22 years old. I got to use a Terratorch, so that was pretty awesome. That I never heard of the Terratorch. It was just this office chair on the back of a truck, and I had no idea that kind of thing existed. I remember sending pictures to my friends back home, and they just didn't believe that it was real, you know, what was actually happening. But this was standard, you know, throughout the year, 30 or 40 burns. You know, it was really all that we did. Very active management, and it set the tone that fuels is really all that I'm interested in. If there's medical aid, I can call for a helicopter. I can stop bleeding, but I'm a fuels person, so this is what I want to be doing. You know, I want to be using this and creating the fendable areas. You know, fire adapted ecosystems. I mean, that's what I want to be doing. So, you know, as an implementer, it was easy. You know, just get the torch, and all we did was burn. But over time, you know, just learn how involved, especially in the West, what it took. Not so much in Florida, because it was just a one-page burn plan and no NEPA, which I don't know how they got away with that, but that's how they did it. So, that's how I started, and that's what I want to be doing. But now the task was to figure out how to bring that to the other places. As I'm responsible for the program, you know, how do we just get to just use the Terratorch like 50 days a year? That's all I really want to be doing. That's my goal, but it's not so easy. So So I didn't want to stay in Florida forever because it was just 500 fishermen in my town, and there wasn't really any surf, there wasn't any skiing, so I everyone in the state, you know, there was no step increase, there was no real job opportunity, it was just that job forever, you know, one salary forever. So everyone in the system, similar to here, that, you know, there are other agencies that can be attractive. And all we talked about as the ground level people were working for the feds, getting out west, and being in fire. So after a couple of years in the south, I just applied everywhere in the west, and it was an obsession. And just got my application out of everywhere. I didn't really care where I was going to end up. Just had my dog, and we ended up in this is Hanford Reach National Monument. Has anyone ever heard of that? I'd never heard of it before that either. It's in eastern Washington. It's in an area around the Tri-Cities. It's with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Got a seasonal job there on a fire engine. And, you know, I thought, well, this is great. You know, we'll just probably end up doing, you know, looked on their website. They had prescribed burning fuels and all this, you know, fancy, you know, things that I took the job and took 7 days, drove across the, you know, diagonal across the country with my dog. And we showed up, and what actually happened was the backside was that, or the backstory was that this refuge was a horseshoe shaped, and it surrounded the Hanford Reach, the Hanford nuclear dumping site. It's where they built big, I think Fat Bob or the Manhattan Project. I don't, you know, it was it's where they built the bomb that they took over to Japan. So that's and all the nuclear rods, plutonium rods, or, you know, whatever. That's where they stored all that crap. So Hanford Reach National Monument was a fancy way of saying it's a buffer for nuclear waste. And now I was on the fire crew that was going to be taking the smoke, and we weren't going to be doing any fuels projects or anything. It was all grass, and the job was basically, all we did was sit in station and wait for grass fires. We didn't go. It was 2003. We didn't go to Montana. We didn't go, you know, all these places were going crazy. And I saw, you know, from in the beginning where we were, all we did was burn, and morale was high. You know, everybody got along, to a place where all we did was sit in station. And there are a lot of personnel issues. I got fired, actually, from that job because I'm kind of quiet, but then also... I challenged that, you know, I was insubordinate. That's what I got fired for. So it happens, I guess. It never happened before, hadn't happened since, thankfully. But it was a, you know, I think in your careers it's good to see the good and the bad, you know, and to me, I mean, it was obvious we were so high functioning in the South, and all we did was produce, and then we just went to the place where we just sat and people talked about each other, and it was just so toxic, obviously. And so I was just there 6 months, but, you know, it was a wrong turn. But, you know, I just leaned back to fuels that I think is good for getting people out, getting them engaged, you know, and seeing the connection in fire, and community defense, and all these just good things instead of just sitting and waiting. And so that really ingrained pretty deep with me that's not what I'm interested in. You know, that kind of management, or just it was awful, but they didn't like me either, so it worked out.
Hey, Dan.
Dan,
you know, were there people that liked being there, or
it was
long-termers there, or
there were a few people. It was real small, maybe six, there were two engines. There was a Type 5 massive thing, and a Type 6, and they were all had been there forever, and they just it's what they knew. So I didn't fit in with them at all. And, you know, I challenged, said, you know, are there things we can be doing? But I was just a seasonal, so, you know, you don't do those, you don't say those things when you're not in charge. So yeah, I mean, it was, I thought it was a valuable experience, you know, to go through. So I made a couple friends on the refuge, and by chance, someone working for the Fish and Wildlife Service in Minnesota, he had a buddy on the refuge, and he was just passing through. And one of my friends had a barbecue one night, and I went over, I was hiking with my dog in Oregon that day, and he called me and said, you gotta come over and meet this guy. So I did, I went over there late, and there was this other guy named Dan, and he was playing his guitar and drinking mead. I didn't know what mead was, and offered some mead. And we started talking about fire ecology and prescribed burning, and he eventually, I just stayed in touch with him, and he gave me a job in Minnesota on this other refuge where it flipped back, and all they did was prescribed burning. Every day we were either ramping up, prepping for a burn, burning, you know, monitoring the burn, going to other regions, you know, other refuges. It was madness, and I loved that. It was, you know, back, and it, you know, the morale was high. I just saw the, you know, the difference in how the two programs were managed. That everyone was miserable in Washington, same job, same grade, seasonal, in Minnesota, and all we did was burn. You know, it was grass, tall grass, prairie restoration burns along river corridors where cottonwoods would get established, and they, you know, pull out a lot of the water from the rivers, and we just burned all that stuff back, and it was so much fun, and so that it was, you know, reaffirmation that's, you know, what I thought of an easy way for, you know, high functioning workforce. You know, everybody was fired up about fire ecology and burning, and then about May and June, the grass would come up, green grass, and then everyone would go out west and you work on your qual. So it was, you know, when it would cure out in the fall, everybody would come back and burn again. But it was that return, you know, and that cycle, you know, of burning for good cause, and that was I just again really enjoyed that. And it was just by chance. I don't know what I'd be doing if I didn't go over there that night and meet that guy. You know, still friends with him. It's been a long time, but he gave me a second chance, and I was really fortunate. You know, in we used all kinds of new tools. This is it's called a Marshmaster. Has anyone ever seen or heard of this thing? It's a bulldozer that floats, which is kind of a crazy idea because bulldozers are heavy. They're pontoons, so these are, they're empty. They actually they can fill them up with some water. So they have a little, this is a Terra Torch again, which is awesome. And then on the other side was a little pump, and so you could be, you know, they would push down a wet line with this thing, you know, smack down the grass. And on the other side, you know, somebody would be standing out the back lighting with the Terra Torch. So, you know, just good exposure, all kinds of new tools, and the enthusiasm was high. Everybody was excited about what we were doing, you know, in the fuels program.
How could you not be happy mobbing around one of those?
Right. Yeah. They're awesome.
Something to play with, don't we have?
Yeah. And I mean, it floats too. Like, it just spins. I mean, how does the tank float? But, you know, and then you put a Terra Torch on it, and I mean, what?
Bonus.
But then after a season there, I, you know, it was a tiny town again, and that wasn't much fun. So, you know, again, peppered the West but was specific to places that did prescribed burning, because I saw, you know, still not too far into it, but I ended up getting a permanent job out in southwestern Colorado, and when they called to offer the job, I knew I'd put in for several jobs in Colorado and talked to a lot of people there, but I thought it was around Vail, so I was pretty excited that I was going to move to Vail, with, you know. And then they're like, no, it's Swatch. And I was like, shit, can you spell that? I don't even know, like, where the hell that is. And then I, just because I was just getting confused with the places I was talking about, because there, you know, there were several prescriber and programs in Colorado that was, I thought it was a good move. The living was incredible. A lot of single tree fires. We did, again, prescribed burning in, you know, places where the Doug fir was encroaching, and we were, you know, pushing the Doug fir back. Again, all we did in the summer, there wasn't any idle time at all. All we did was fuels projects, ran the saw all year. You know, not really any training. I was getting quals, but, you know, I was an engine boss, but we never ran the pump on any of the fires at all, because we just hiked. It was just single tree. We hiked to everything, so I was thinking, well, maybe it's probably not a good idea to be an engine boss, but to not really have rerunning you know, bump on a lot of fires because it's just not a diverse, you know, you go take the engine someplace busy and you know, it's going to be a different story. So it's when came down to region 5, and I remember the day before, 2 days before I got the job. I think I got it on the 24th in Fire Hire in 2006, and the Esperanza fire was 2 days later on the 26th, and I just remember thinking, I mean, I wonder if that was a Cleveland engine, because I know that they all, you know, interchange, and that was a pretty profound moment to see the connection, you know, and as the details came out, and just that, you know, where the engine was, what it was doing, you know, structure protection, standing a fire at night. It's a really complicated position that it was in, and that has been probably the number one influencer for the path that I've taken with, you know, with developing projects in communities where we can, you know, take where our people end up, maybe at night, maybe in wind events. I mean, you know, the fuels projects don't always buy you 100% safety, but, you know, look, my projects focus on evacuation routes, defense zones, you know, in places where you can make a stand, where you can be safe. You know, I integrate safety zones into my fuels project. So on my district, on the Angeles, I passed the baton to Seth, but over the past couple years, we developed on across the district all buildings that the Forest Service has their hands in, special use cabins, comm sites, fire stations, anything where we own the land and have say in defensible space. When you bring a module, you know, an engine, a crew there, you're going to have defensible space at all those places, and it happened because of the Esperanza fire. So that's that tie of, you know, fires that you hear about, you experience, you know, things that you see, and putting them together and designing, you know, developing a project that you think is going to work, you know, for you and in your response zone, in your area that you're, you know, where your module is stationed. So that's kind of starting into the project development. Just that's where I get my ideas for putting together these projects for the why. So that, you know, when you're questioned by the Halseys or, you know, the different academics or different agencies or, you know, wildlife biologists, it comes back to the purpose of why. And, you know, is this something that is this an area where you think there is a need to develop a project? So that's trying to hone in, you know, on projects that make sense. You know, considering strategy and tactics in the areas, maybe, you know, close calls where you took a module in and thought, I don't want to be in here, I don't want to go in there. You know, when you see a big header going into a community and you're going in, you know, what is there any defensible space in there at all? You know, what are you looking at? So that's you know, when you go into an area and then you see an old prescribed burn and you think, well, this changes everything. You know, now you're in a comfortable place, or you have those advantages. You know, that's where I strive with my fuels program on the district, and, you know, new to a new forest. But you know, that's kind of some background into the why. You know, how you develop these projects. Do you want to take a break? Because I don't know if it's been an hour.
Yeah, we can't. Well, we break for lunch about 11:30.
Okay, I can go to 11:30 and then. Yeah. Everybody good? Okay, so once I got to the Cleveland, you know, had that fuel background and interest, and Brian Rhodes, he had just moved from Alpine Captain to Battalion 43, New Fuels Battalion. And as soon as I met him, I said, hey, you know, I'm interested. I've got some mapping skills. You know, do you have any projects that I can help you out with in the winter? And he, you know, the next winter, I started as a, what do you guys call them? It's Fuels 43 on that district?
Yeah,
that, I did that for 3 years working for Brian. You know, I never had a truck. You know, now Jamie's got a real fancy truck, but I just had the surplus stuff that was about to be sold and painted and had a New Jersey tag on it. So a lot of times I'd go to get gas and the car wouldn't work because Cliff would be like, that truck needs to be, you know, truck's out of service. So Brian would come and fill my truck up and pay for my, you know, gas. As I understand it, that position, you know, had just been, over the years, that I wasn't the first one in the position, you know, it kind of ebbed and flowed. It was always on the org chart, but I was able to do that, that detail for a few years, you know, worked on Brian's projects for community protection, you know, started inspecting contracts, you know, working on GPS and mapping. That's a critical skill, you know, as you move from fire into fuels. That's definitely a weakness of the Forest Service, I think, you know, developing GIS and mapping skills, and that's something I'm talking to the folks in Utah about, you know, developing something that's where you don't need a Class 3 computer with ARC software, that it bogs down any computer that's not a Class 3 designed for it. There's ArcGIS online. I'm looking to start putting on sessions on our forest, you know, for getting, maybe, you know, you can help with, you know, getting that baseline information and knowledge and skill out for, yeah, got a question?
About that, where does KML fit into that?
So KML is Google Earth.
Yeah.
So that's you know, that's one aspect of it. I use more GIS than Google Earth. I think it's good for presentations, but you know, as far as creating, I don't know that I've ever taken a GPS track and put it into Google Earth. Is that possible?
Yeah.
So yeah, and you know, they're just looking at all the different options, put everything out there, and how to get that skill. But you know, if it's through Google Earth, if it's through ArcGIS online, which is new, you know, similar to Google Earth with some editing. So that's, you know, I think that's an important skill to kind of get out, you know, to get to the folks so they've got that ability for making maps and bringing in data from the field. Gave me experience with burn unit layout and photo documentation. Found over the years that, you know, we're not so good about, you know, it's easy to get the post-fire effects and pictures, but the pre-fire, you know, that stuff really tells the story. And Brian had me working extensively on some photo documentation. We've got all the units, 50 units up on Mount Laguna. Walked that entire mountain one spring, and you know, so when fires come across, there's that baseline data of what it looked like before, you know, before the treatments happen. And then you can compare it afterwards, and that'll help you calibrate, you know, are you doing good, or are you, you know, is it maybe damaging what you're doing? So it's good to have that photo documentation. Got exposed to the land management plan, wilderness areas and IRAs, and how, you know, through GIS, how to locate those. And those are skills on fires, you know, you quickly need to know where you can run a dozer. You know, can you put initial attack, all kinds of things are coming your way. You have dozers on the dispatch, but you know, when you're in charge, you know, you want to very quickly realize if you're in a wilderness area, if it's moving towards there. You know, the county, I know LA County, they love to drop the dozers and run them, but if it's on our land, you know, do you have that knowledge? You know, are you allowed, you know, through the land management plan to run dozers? You know, how do you quickly establish where that wilderness is, where the boundary is, and IRAs, those inventory roadless areas, those are changing, new ones are coming up online, but the responsibility is on the IC. So it was a good skill in the winter to develop for the summer, you know, for quickly gathering that information about just where you're looking to put those dozers. So I did that for 4 years, and just really loved the fuels aspect of it. So started looking for permanent. You know, that job was on the org chart for years, and they were talking about making it permanent. It didn't look like it was going to happen, so I looked for other opportunities. I like the independence of being a fuels tech, so I took a fuels tech job in Utah. You know, to focus solely on fuels, just to get back, you know, in the feds, and the fuels route was where I wanted to go. In the snow, I happened upon a really good snow year, so that was just lucky that happened, and I was just kind of done with the engines after, you know, I just would rather work independent and get to be involved in all kinds of different projects. I was responsible for writing burn plans for mechanical prep. We had a small masticator that, you know, we would prep some of our burns for, crew briefing, getting exposure to NEPA, interdisciplinary teams and who all the players were on the districts and developing these plans, you know, went for basically becoming the lead on implementing these plans, but then still no power in where the projects happened, and, you know, so almost where I could start developing the projects, but, you know, just carrying out someone else's plans. There were some, you know, a lot of good, you know, they kind of did things different in Utah, you know, alternative burning techniques. Something that they would do, which I thought was really cool, it was the Wasatch Cache in Uinta National Forest. It was 4 million acres, and on the Wyoming side, they would drive in early in the morning, and in certain areas after a snowstorm, they had these big, they were wildlife-driven burns. It was for wildlife benefit, and they wanted a mosaic in sage, which is difficult to do because it's like a, you know, mosaic in. They just wanted random patches, different sizes in sage, and that's, you know, sage is, it kind of burns all or none. So what we decided to do was to look at burning, you know, in the south aspect, when it would, in the spring, we would just burn those strips off. It was still, you know, hadn't taken any moisture up, and it was, you know, snow all around it on the north aspect. All the other aspects but the south, you know, we had these nice little, you know, kind of oval-shaped, circular mosaic, and that, so I thought that worked pretty good, and I never heard or thought of doing that before, but that's just how they, you know, that's how they operated, so it was good for kind of a new idea. We had to get trained on snowmobiles, and I did a little bit in Colorado, and we always had to stay below 20 miles an hour on snowmobiles, and they're always overheating, and I learned in Utah, where there were professionals, I learned by this, he was a Mormon preacher, I think, you know, very religious, very conservative, and he put on the snowmobile class, and he was, I was going like 65 miles an hour, I couldn't keep up with them, thought it was kind of unsafe, but that's, you know, he said, you have to run these things hot, you know, fast, they're going to run hot, so it was one of the craziest days of my life. We were dropping cornices, and just these huge bowls, and, you know, kind of high marking, all this stuff, and he's like, you got to know how to do all this stuff. I was like, sure. Okay, whatever. I just follow him off another, you know, 20-foot cornice, you know, on the clock, thinking, this is insane. You know, the 70-year-old Mormon preacher guy told me how to, you know, to rev it up on a government-owned sled, so that was pretty cool. Then, you know, just asking around, and that led to other forests, that, and they really played with their live fuel moistures, which, you know, I've met one of the fire guys from the Monti LaSalle around Moab, and he would talk about his projects, and they were focusing on knocking back conifer in aspen stands, but they had a lot of sage around, so they would burn those stands really hot in June when the sage had pulled up the moisture first, but the conifer hadn't pulled up the moisture, and I just, you know, it was just like this big control panel. And I thought, that's how you burn. You know, with full confidence, they were burning those units really hot, you know, sage all around it, but it wouldn't go anywhere. So that was, again, just another perspective, an outside perspective on maybe different ways to do things, you know, with knowing those live fuel moistures and playing with them, and, you know, what can you get done, and maybe different alternatives. So I thought that was pretty useful. And again, you know, just more slides for developing your own projects and what's feasible, and, you know, how you can make something work that's maybe difficult. A bad side of working in Utah is fire and fuels. It's a 10-year fire cycle there. You know, the fires are really bad every 10 years or so. You know, not like here where you get, you know, in fire and fuels, you're front and center. We're going to have bad fires. They're going to happen. You know, projects are important. But there, recreation was important. You know, Snowbird and Brighton and all these big resorts, you know, they were on Forest Service land, so they took a lot of time. Wildlife took a lot of time, so it was that was kind of the bad side down here where the big bad fire program and there's no stopping us. But in other regions, you know, you don't have that kind of leverage in cloud where your projects rise to the top, you get the specialist time that we were kind of, you know, in the backseat, and, you know, we would burn some wildlife projects, but didn't have a lot of influence because in reality, it probably wasn't going to burn, you know. So that was a big reason why, you know, like working down here is that these projects are important to do. You know, got to be strategic with them, with where you build them. So and that's where, you know, as a fuel specialist, you know, I'm sure that, you know, during the NEPA talk that Jeff did, you know, and in fire, you guys probably, you know, you consider other, you know, wildlife biologists, the botanists, the archaeologists, they're the specialists, but, you know, fuels and fire, you're a specialist as well, that you've got, you know, knowledge, you know, you bring fire experience to the table, you know, I've seen projects that are designed that don't take into account workable ridges, or, you know, they'll want to put in mid-slope lines, or, you know, you're the fire and fuel specialist that says this is workable, or this is, you know, you can steer those projects. You know, you're equal seat at the table as the other specialist to say, you know, we can do this, or no, you can't do this. You know, starting to see it, you know, are there effective projects that you've been working on, or projects that aren't effective? You know, the new equipment's available. You know, fire behavior knowledge. You know, are these, again, you bring that specialty, are these projects doable, and are they going to be effective that's being designed by rec or timber or, you know, wildlife, that you can steer that thing back and say, what you're proposing is, it's not going to work, or it will work, you know, we can make that happen. So as a fuel specialist, that's some power in the fire experience background to steer it back on track. And if you're going to be the implementer, you know, is this project, is it feasible? And, you know, also sharing your ideas, your experiences with other forests, to see, you know, what works here, what works in other places. Got 2012, came back to the Angeles and was then was in charge of the program on my district. Just told, you know, real old school. He was Eric McCormick. He had been on the district forever on the Angeles. Man of very high integrity. Really looked up to him. But he just wanted a fuels nerd. He just said, I just need a fuels program. I got a fuels, you know, just go and do fuel stuff. That's it. That was the only direction that I got from him. So, you know, it was all of a sudden, you know, you could wind up in a place where you don't get any direction. You just are told, use your background, start developing projects, start making stuff happen. So, you know, where do you start with developing projects? You know, what do you, let's see if, okay, so, yeah, where do you, so if you're all of a sudden given the steering wheel on your district or your forest, you know, where do you start? What are you working with? Is there leadership support for what you're doing? Are you going to be working in a vacuum? You know, you spent all this time on this project. Is it going to be effective? Is it, you know, do you have it, would be funded? I think they're good questions to get out ahead, instead of, you know, working, you know, kind of in a box and not knowing, you know, if all your efforts are going to be, you know, for good or not. So I immediately you know, started to scout when I got the job, and just didn't have a lot of background projects, you know, in place. And so I just started, I got the quad maps out and thought about the Esperanza fire, and thought I would go and look at the condition of the structures, you know, where we're gonna have fires or where we have structures, and you know, are there projects to get off the ground and maybe start developing. That was my original goal in fuels. And so I just drove out to San Dimas Canyon, you know, right above the San Dimas, town of San Dimas. Was anybody on the Williams fire? You know, so if you were on that fire, you knew that all those houses were burned in the Williams fire. I didn't know that it was still on the map, but I thought that was pretty profound that, on our forest maps, it showed 100 structures in there, but in reality, they're all gone, they're all burned. So that was, it was substantial to see that, what happened. I don't know that those were built in places where you want to be at all for a fire. I think it was just evacuated, and it actually helped the district out at all. There's a lot of crime in there, but it was a place to start, fires do burn houses. Yeah, you're on track. That was day one. And then did anybody go to the Curve fire on the Angeles? So next day, drove up San Gabriel Canyon, and same deal, about 100 special use cabins, all of them burned in the Curve fire. So that, talking to some of the local engine captains, that there were some pretty hairy conditions for that fire. People were scattering, there were some near burnovers in this canyon, people defending houses. So that was just some on track. I just have to catch, kind of get out ahead of the fires instead of 10 years behind them. But it was only been there a week or so, so just had to figure out, where there hadn't been fires, where stuff was still standing, and start developing some projects from there. So going, you want to, any projects you develop, they've got to be in line with policy. The Southern California Land Management Plan, Goal 1.1, improve the ability of Southern California communities, women loss of life and property. That's fires in the interface. To me, Goal 1.1 and 1.2 are heavily involved with fuels projects. Defensible space in the first one. Fuel breaks and fuels projects in timber stands in number two. So we're, in Utah, we were down in like goal 10.5 or whatever. But back in Southern California, it's front and center. Goal in the first goal, second goal, fire and fuels are right in the middle of it. So this is started developing projects here, went out and GPSed. It's in San Gabriel Canyon where we did have a few structures left. Got a GPS point, consulted the land management plan. We're allowed to do, the homeowners are supposed to be doing 100 feet of clearance, so that was their responsibility. But is that enough? If all those homes had burned, in some of these, in the Curve and Williams fire, they just had 100 feet, was that adequate? And I was thinking in a lot of these places, probably not. And that's where the fuels program would come in. Looking at, it's 300 feet buffer around the homes and then around the access. So this is an evacuation route, defensible space project around the communities, kind of mix of what the terrain would allow. But this is where I started developing my project, just based on, the Esperanza fire. Looking at where, just up, this is where the near burnover happened up on the Curve fire. So this is just down the canyon where below where the fire burns, and just start looking at, that type of effect for projects. These aren't in the backcountry. They're not, they're not to get people out of the station. These are places where the Rincon fire station is just down the road. It's got two engines and a water tender, and they're going to be responding quickly into these areas. So I'm looking to build them something to work off of, places that they'll work. They're going to run projects in those communities, and it'll be, as homeowners come up, or as, visitors come up, they'll see our trucks working, and they'll ask what they're doing, and they're there to complement the efforts of the private homeowners. So they're working together, focused efforts on the district. Pretty low impact. A lot of stuff is flat. Run the masticator in some of these areas. Run the chipper and start breaking apart some of that fuel, so that instead of being 10-foot brush, in here. It's it's always going to depend on the fire and the situation, but I feel like it's working towards making areas that are safer, you know, not bulletproof and not guaranteed all the time, but at least you know something better than it is, you know, currently. So that's kind of where I started with making projects. Another part of that project, this is Sunset Peak. They're all, these are communication towers, NBC, LA County Sheriff, you know, they're all, prevention sends out the letter that says do your clearance, and they do it. But I saw this as being, if these were to burn the next fire, that's 10-foot brush, 15 feet off of the structures, we're sending that letter. And I saw that as us sending a letter saying we're liable. You know, we're telling you 10 feet is fine. And then when it burns, in 5 or 10 years, they're going to come back and say, well, you sent us, you're the experts. You sent us this letter, and all our millions of dollars of infrastructure destroyed. So here's the bill for it. So that's integrating more fuels projects into defending not just the infrastructure, but also the liability of the taxpayers. You know, that we're separating us from, kind of standing back and saying, this needs 300 feet of clearance. You know, if this is going to burn, high intensity, your responsibility is 300 feet. If you don't want to do it, it's fine. You know, but we're not responsible for this anymore. But as it stood, we were. So that's another place to just wander around your district and seeing where these projects would, where you can be effective. This isn't something that the engine or the modules would be working on. This would be basically the project specs saying, we have nesting birds, we have these species, here's our mitigations, but you need to pay for this, you need to do it, and we're no longer liable for your equipment. It's on our land that we're telling you. We're not going to tell you 10 feet anymore, we're going to tell you 300 feet, and that's that. You know, it's going to be expensive, but it's no longer our responsibility to, to defend this stuff. You're going to put it up there, you need to defend it. That's probably a good place to stop for lunch.
Cool, man. Alright, so we'll break till 12:15. Is it 45 minutes enough time for you guys? Have you been fighting it? Mm-hmm. Yeah, 45 minutes or so.
Okay.
So, try to get back. Alright, thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Yeah, I got some.